You guys forgot the part where you murder each other. That was supposed to come next. That's all right.
Yeah, where's the blood?
Thank you.
Welcome to the Riff Crew. I'm your host, Steve Mitchell. It's been a while, but we're back here at the Riff Crew, and I'm joined, as always, by my great mate over in Washington, D.C., Skull. How are you doing?
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, Cyberland. This is Skull, broadcasting from the past, present, and the future in the Chamber of the Cosmos, here with my good friend Steve Oz. I'm in the Off Again, On Again, D.C. Bomb Rock band Black Manta. I've been in the D.C. scene for over 30 years. I know all kinds of people. I know you might have seen me here and there, but I'm really here to fill in for Andrew for a while. Hope maybe I'll be here for the long term. Who knows? But I'm always excited to be here. And this is a little bit of a different segment. We might have mentioned it in the previous shows. This is going to be one of those great gigs in the sky where we had kind of talked about it in our previous shows, but it was kind of getting buried in the interviews because some of those can go long. So we kind of broke this out so we could talk more about our fallen rock and roll brethren and fellow disciples of Orpheus. And so in the future, we might be talking about, might have some special ones that we hadn't never, well, you know, that people that have passed away a long time ago, like Dio and Lemmy, et cetera, like that. But for today, I'm excited to talk about, and sad to talk about. Obviously, there's two people we'll be discussing. But before we do that, is there anything you want to talk about? Anything topical, anything going on in the world with this, all this COVID shit seems to be kind of wrapping up. And now there's the war in Ukraine. A lot of people think that we're living in some kind of dark timeline, that this is World War III. I don't know. I'm a little bit older than you, so I grew up with, I'm a Cold War, what they call Cold War kids. I grew up under the imminent and constant threat of nuclear annihilation. That's why I listened to thrash metal. It's one of the reasons I probably gravitated towards heavy metal, because it was a kind of like release. I don't know, but like Nuclear Assault and, you know, bands like that. But how you been, man? How you been holding up in this in 2022?
Yeah, it's strange times. I try not to get involved in hysteria when it comes to anything, unless it's like a really good rock and roll show. Then I'll get dragged into the hysteria, maybe dragged into the mosh pit, but that's about it.
Okay.
So yeah, I think it's not quite turn on, tune in, drop out, but you know, it's kind of like keep it to the peripheral.
Well, this will probably be, you know, me and Steve have been talking about, you know, this Great Gig in the Sky segment and also an Electric Church segment that we've done a couple of. Unfortunately, when it comes to the Great Gig in the Sky, since I know some of the older fossil guys and acid rock bands and all these other bands, I'm more familiar with them, and they're the ones that are starting to kick off, you know, these days. You know, their time's running out. That of course I'm probably going to be running these shows, these segments, but obviously, you know, we'll talk about it and you can chime in with your thoughts. But this specific one is going to be, you know, Leslie West. I mentioned him before in when we did the greatest albums, top 10 albums of 1970, I mentioned Mountain. I touched on it a little bit then because he had passed away, and that's been a few months past now. But I just wanted to take this opportunity, since we're doing these segments now, to really talk about his importance in the evolution of everything that became heavy metal and, you know, hard rock, and even all that evolved up all the way up into new wave of British heavy metal, all the way up to thrash. I mean, because that's the logical progression. That's how evolution works. And I thought it was really important to talk about him as someone. I mean, I don't even really play the guitar, but I mean, you don't have to play like Jimi Hendrix. You don't have to play the guitar to know this guy's a genius. But, you know, I'll just say, kind of, once upon a time, it all kind of started with a guy named Felix Pappalardi, who was this crazy New York hippie producer. and he produced what is arguably considered the greatest acid rock albums of all time. He produced Disraeli Gears and Wheels of Fire. And but that being said, everyone always knows now and forever that this is the greatest acid rock album of all time. So I just had to throw that in there. But anyway, Felix, he produced these two albums, and also Goodbye. I don't have that. I didn't show it here, but he produced these two albums, and which I said that, you know, the Cream and Jimi Hendrix are experienced those, and the Disraeli Gears. Those albums were the blueprint for that heavy acid rock, psychedelic rock, counterculture explosion that was happening in 67. And Felix Pappalardi was right on the pulse of that. And he loved that music, and he was an amazing producer. And he, you know, those albums are master, like, sonic masterpieces. Well, the band, you know, they once, like a lot of those bands, they, you know, they burned out very quickly, you know, like a supernova. They just exploded onto the scene, changed the world, and just, you know, just vanished. I mean, or moved on to other projects, etc. But when Cream broke up, Felix was so, I guess, upset about it. He was like, the world cannot exist without Cream. There has to be a Cream in the world, a Cream-like band. So he took it upon himself to create a new Cream band, and that band was because Cream is English, they're British, you know, Ginger Baker, Jack Bruce, and Eric Clapton, all Brits. Felix, you know, a New York crazy Greek guy, you know, Pappalardi, he took it upon himself to make the American version of Cream, and he did that by discovering Leslie West, the great Fatsby. This fat guy with this amazing voice, amazing guitar tone, amazing style, just overall. Leslie West was a young kid. He was already in a band called The Vagrants, so he was already kind of out there musically. And Felix kind of picked him up and brought him in, and is like, he's like, we're going to create something amazing. And one of the very first gigs, and I have to show this, is that was Woodstock. Mountain played in front of 500,000 people or whoever, at, you know, at the, it's arguable whatever the numbers were. But when those albums were released, there's a Woodstock, and there's a Woodstock 2 album, and the Woodstock 2 just has more songs from the festival. But if a lot of people don't know this, but if you look at these little, you know, angelic, these little Cupid kids here on the stage, that's actually Mountain's gear. This is the Mountain drum set and the Mountain amps. And I know that because Leslie West played one of those funky Paul McCartney violin bass things. And that's what this is. That's Felix. Not only was Felix Pappalardi the producer of the band, he's like, if I'm going to create a Cream band, I'm going to be in it. So Felix sang, played bass, obviously co-wrote the songs and produced them. So it's just really important. I just wanted to show that, but obviously not just that, but that first Mountain album, Leslie West is kind of a solo album, but then after that it becomes a band, Mountain Climbing, and then The Road Goes Forever On, which is, this is an amazing live album. The fidelity is A+, the playing is just stellar, off the charts. I mean, cosmic, really. These are, you know, once again, I talk about, you know, Sonic Wizards, Leslie West and Felix Pappalardi, and they trade off vocals too. Heavy bass fuzz. Felix was a volume freak. I think he actually went deaf from playing his bass so loud. He went deaf over the years, but he was a volume freak. And so that's a live album. These are kind of in chronological order here. I have everything that Leslie West did that's worth a shit. You know, up until like the mid 70s. And he was incredibly prolific, which is between like 69 and 75 or 6, he released like, I don't know, I have like 13 albums here. It's crazy. You know, there's Nantucket Sleigh Ride. And then this is a split, Flowers of Evil, one side live, one side studio. And then you got Twin Peaks, when they broke up a little bit and then they got back together to do this live one in Japan. And then Mountain Avalanche, which is their last, is like their last hurrah album from the 70s. They just couldn't get along for whatever reason. And a lot of people don't know this, but being such a fat guy, Leslie West was a heroin addict. He was a heroin freak. Typically they're skinny, but not Leslie. But and so after that, you know, Mountain broke up, and this is actually kind of in between Mountain years, but who better to get together with than Jack Bruce from Cream? So he started a band with Jack Bruce from Cream called the West Bruce and Lang Band. And it's actually on the same Windfall label, which is, that was actually, Felix started his own label. All the smart guys back then started their own labels. But West Bruce and Lang, so he went from Mountain to West Bruce and Lang. Another West Bruce and Lang album where you see the fat guy eating the hamburger. That's what fat guys do, they eat hamburgers. And so there's Leslie. Oh, there's a whole tape. There's a whole table. He's eating a whole table of hamburgers here.
How does it compare to the Mountain back catalog?
Huh?
How do those albums compare to the Mountain back catalog?
I own them, don't I?
Yeah, well.
They're fucking amazing.
Are they as good as Mountain or better? Or
they're not better than Mountain, but they're pretty damn close. They're pretty damn close. And this is a live one. They released two studio albums and then two live and then a live album. And then after that, they were all junkies. I don't know about Corky, but I know that Jack Bruce was, he was riding that fucking dragon, and so was Leslie West. But that's why they were in the band together. And then I guess they were both trying to get clean or whatever. And then Leslie West went solo, and then he created and then wrote, there's an album here called The Great Fatsby. And there he is, The Great Fatsby himself, with some hot chicks, of course, because it's The Great Fatsby. And then after that, there's one last album that he did that's really amazing. Mick Jones from Foreigner, love him or hate him, Mick Jones started off in the Leslie West band. He was also in Spooky Tooth before the Leslie West band, but Mick Jones is in this, and this is fantastic. And that's a good question. But, you know, how do those albums hold up? If you're a Leslie freak and you love his tone, you love his voice, I mean, they're great. Arguably, you could say that this is probably the greatest Mountain album. It has Mississippi Queen on it. Live-wise, it's, I would have to say it's The Road Goes Forever On. There's only four tracks on here. Some long jams. Side two is 120-minute jam, Nantucket Sleigh Ride. Long ass fucking kick ass jam. But I also have this. This is a very famous bootleg. New Year's Eve 1970, live at the Fillmore East. There were two Fillmore Easts. There was one in the West in San Francisco, and there was one in the East in New York. and they were both run by Bill Graham, not Billy Graham, the crazy fucking TV evangelist, Bill Graham, the concert and music promoter, who was really into this music and really into the counterculture and into the scene. There was a Fillmore in San Francisco and one in New York. And there's many, many famous, high quality, amazing bootlegs from bands from Mountain to the Quicksilver Messenger Service to Santana to Blue Cheer, etc. But this is a really amazing, amazing bootleg. I'm super picky with this A-plus quality. Live at the Fillmore East, New Year's Eve, 1970. But that's a really good question. I mean, how do those albums hold up? And like I said, there's a reason they're in my collection, because they're fucking awesome. I mean, but you know, there is that you got Jack Bruce from Cream, you know, who arguably was the progenitor to all of this and the blueprint for all this. But you have Felix Popolardi, and he is a bit of the secret weapon, if you will, because he is such an amazing singer. You wouldn't think it, because he started off in bands before he became a producer, but he is such kind of a honey tone the way he sings. But I would say all of those are, if you're into Leslie West tone at all of those are essential. All of them, all the way up to the Leslie West Brent band, which I believe is 75 or 6. I'm a bit of a freak, as you can see. I was very fortunate. I got to see him 3 times. I got to see him kind of all in the mid to late O's. I got to see him in like 04, 05 at that legendary club called Jack's that I've talked about before. And it was just Leslie West solo. But me and Hillel went, we were just ecstatic just to see the man, just to see him play. And then later on, a couple of years later, he got back together with Corky Lang. Felix Popolardi tragically was murdered in the early 80s by his jealous wife. And she shot him to death. So that's really sad and tragic in itself. But they got back together in the mid to late O's. And when Corky rejoined the band, they renamed it Mountain. As Mountain, you know, not Leslie West Mountain, but Mountain. And I got to see him twice then. I got to see them one time by themselves. I can't remember who opened up for them, but there was one time it was Mountain, Vanilla Fudge, which is another acid rock band from New York, and Canned Heat. So that was kind of a cool thing. And that was at the new 930 club, which is a legendary DC band. But, you know, really just wanted to recognize Leslie's genius and, you know, for all the young cats or people out there people of all ages that might know a little bit about him, but might want to go a little bit further. That's why I wanted to show those records. Because he has a lot. And of course, he made stuff all the way up until his death. But, you know, with the new technology and old technology, the way things were recorded and the techniques that were used and the equipment that was used, et cetera, nothing is really going to beat, beat the sounds and the tones of those albums from back then. But, you have any thoughts or input on that, Steve-O? Mr. Steve Oz?
Yeah, Mountain's never been a band I've really got into, because I always...
You don't like fat people?
Yeah, I have a problem against that. Yeah. Yeah, once you go over...
So why is that? Why haven't you gotten in?
No, I think it's more... because I started getting into metal in the 90s...
It's more about opportunity, right? You just never went down that path yet.
Yeah, so my ears expect something a lot heavier. Just because, you know, when you start getting bands, you know, I was listening to bands like Entombed and Cathedral and stuff like that. And
sure.
So, you know, it's a generation later. So going back, it's...
And I mean, I'm the other way, because I started off with that stuff and I built up to, like, you know... the underground, the death metal scene, the doom metal scene. I built up to that. But yeah, you younger guys already started off with that. And so that's what you guys are used to hearing for sure. So all this stuff, this is more of like a history lesson. It's like going back and listening to, these are the grandmasters. These are the astromancers. These are the grand wizards, the sonic grand wizards, you know. These are the true masters of Orpheus.
Yeah, it's a family tree of rock, you know. You know, your legacy is based on your ancestors, and you know, obviously Leslie
absolutely
West was an important part of that.
Yeah, so I mean, if you were to, would you be interested in studio or live? I mean, I can tell you where to start.
It's probably best to recommend one live and one studio album to start off with. What would be the go-to albums?
Okay, well, I would say if you wanted to start off, if you wanted just to familiarize yourself with the genius of Leslie West and Felix, I would say these are the two right here. I would say Mountain, for many, many reasons. Of course, it has Mississippi Queen on it, which is a fucking monster. Talked about me whenever you hear that on the radio. Whenever I hear that on the radio, man, I just fucking crank it. It's one of those songs. So I would start off with Mountain Climbing and Live, like I said. I would say the bootleg, but the bootleg is fucking long. It's two discs. I mean, it was a long jam. Mm-hmm. They probably played for like 2 hours, but this is fantastic. You know, Mississippi Queen isn't on here, but Fidelity and just playing wise and Felix's bass fuzz tone is just out of control, man. It's it sounds like a, I don't know, a golem, like a, you know, some sort of like underworld troll. It's like super buzz, like fuzzy and buzzy. But I would say start off with Mountain Climbing. If you wanted just to get your feet wet with Mountain and Leslie, I would go with these two, Mountain Climbing and the Road Goes Forever On.
Me too. Fucking hell. Coffin just blows my fucking dick to pieces.
Yeah, well, we want to see it by the end of the song. 1, 2, 3.
Enjoy that clip, and we're still in the great gig in the sky. We're moonlighting through the heavens at the moment, or maybe other places. I'm not too sure with these guys, particularly
sure.
With,
the great
Leslie
beyond, man.
His heroin issues. But who's the next guy you'd like to pay tribute to, Skull?
Yeah, I can't remember if I mentioned at the beginning of the segment here, but yeah, this is. I wanted to go back and obviously talk about. You know, Leslie West and his importance in the whole evolution of music and everything. One of the guys, unfortunately, that recently passed away also that definitely deserves to be recognized is Burke Shelley from Budgie. And some people might know him, some people might not. He was the original bass player and singer for Budgie. And Power Trio out of Wales. And he was a bit of a quirky, weird looking guy with glasses, kind of nerdy looking with long hair, kind of has the same kind of high falsetto like Geddy Lee from Rush, which I happen to like, love, my favorite band of all time. As you know, I have them right here. I always bring them with me wherever I go.
It's surgically attached, is it?
Exactly. Yeah. But he, believe it or not, his voice is even more out of control, is the way I would put it, than Geddy Lee's. There's a lot of control in his vocals, and Burke Shelley is more of like a real banshee, the way that he sings. But once again, when me and my friends like Hillel, when we were first went on this odyssey to discover bands, that there has to be other bands out there that sound like Black Sabbath. There has to be. We went on, you know, some people, and we knew about them because of Metallica made them famous with, you know, Crash Course in Brain Surgery. There's that song that they covered on the 598 EP. So, and Metallica also played Bread Fan. So Metallica kind of made Budgie famous, and or basically introduced them to a whole new generation of kids that had never heard of them before. And so some people take that torch and then they, you know, they move on with it. And then, you know, you go down that road and you discover, but you're looking for bands that sound like Black Sabbath, and Budgie is pretty close. I mean, Power Trio, really, really heavy. Tony Borge, the guitar player, is also another Tony Jr. that some people call him, or Tony Two. Great fucking riff master. But you know, God rest Burke's rock and roll soul, along with, you know, Leslie West as well. But you know, I have all of these records too. I mean, this is these albums, the because they're Welsh, if some of them were imports. I mean, they actually did make a little bit of a splash in the US. Obviously the mountain stuff's going to be a lot easier to find here in the States, but the Budgie stuff is not as easy to find. It is kind of sought after and harder to find. But you know, this is the first album. It's incredible. Just great fuzz guitar. The first album is actually produced by Roger Bain, who's the same guy that produced the first two Black Sabbath albums, you know, Sabbath and Paranoid. So there's a bit of a Sabbath connection there as well. And then, of course, you have Budgie, and this was drawn. It looks a little weird, but this was actually done by Roger Dean, famous for his, you know, famous for his Yes album covers. He designed the Budgie the Parakeet spaceman, Budgie astronaut guy, and this weird little fucking thing down here. And then you got Budgie in For the Kill. Never Turn Your Back on a Friend, which is another one of those amazing Roger Dean covers. I wish he had done more. He only did a handful of their covers. But, you know, beggars can't be choosers. At least we have a couple, because it totally fits with their style of music, and it's psychedelic as shit. I mean, look at this. The fucking spaceman. A Budgie writing a Budgie, dude. And there's, I don't know, there was a fucking riddle in there somewhere, I guess. But, and then after that, you got Bandolier. This is 75, and it's like basically fucking Planet of the Apes with fucking Budgies on horses here. But still heavy, man. Still heavy as shit. Power Trio. And this is getting a little bit later. Still great. If I Were in Britannia. Now they're fucking the real Astro Budgies. They have the wearing the fucking space helmets and everything. And then this is the last album with Tony before he split. Impeccable. It's got some real funk in it. They start to get a little funkier. And I have one here. This is without Tony, but this is when Budgie is one of those bands that influenced the new wave of British heavy metal movement, along with Rainbow and Black Sabbath and Deep Purple. But they were one of those bands that were still around when the movement happened. So they were actually re-energized and became even more popular during the new wave of British heavy metal movement. I have this. I'm not a super fan of that period of their stuff, but I have this just because it's fucking awesome. It's Swallow Do Not Induce Vomiting. It's an awesome fucking EP. So I just have to have it. I do like that period. So I just really wanted to have something representative of their new wave of British heavy metal period. And the covers is fucking amazing. So once again, man, just want to recognize our fallen heroes, our fallen brethren. And also, once again, I was very, very fortunate to be able to see Budgie. Obviously, as a younger guy, didn't get to see any of these guys during their heyday. It was all way, way past their heyday. But if we're getting any opportunity to see them I always feel fortunate. I got to see him around the same time I saw Leslie West, and it was also at Jack's. The guy that owned the place, Jack's, J. Nedry, was much older than us, but he went as a kid in his 70s. He was a fucking freak. He was a music freak. He loved all these bands. And so when he got older and he had his club, he would go out of his way to say, hey, I love your music. I want you to come and play at my club. And of course, who wouldn't appreciate that? So he got all these amazing acts to come there. And at the time, Burke was actually living in Texas. He wasn't even living in England or Wales. And so he got them to come, and me and Hello, we got to go see Budgie around 05 or 06 or something like that. So I feel very fortunate we got to see them when they were still around.
How was the live experience?
Not quite up to what we were hoping for, but we got to see them. You know what I mean? I guess. And the cool thing is like they went through drummers the way fucking Spinal Tap went through drummers, you know. But up until the Bandolier, this guy, Steve Williams. When they finally got this guy, Steve Williams, in the band, he stuck with Burke all the way to the end. So it was cool that there was still the same rhythm section. It wasn't the same guitar player. Tony wasn't in the band. He had already moved on. After he left Budgie, he started a band called Tredegar. They only had one album. I have a very rare video of them and floating around in the chamber here. It's one of my prized artifacts, actually. He got the band. Tredegar actually was the original drummer of Budgie back into Tredegar. And, fuck is his name? I got his name right here. And anyway, that's all. The Tredegar is awesome. But just wanted to recognize our fallen heroes, fallen, you know, brethren, disciples of Orpheus. And let me know if you have any thoughts or any, you know, I can give you some recommendations or if you're familiar with Budgie at all. I mean, it's important for people to know that, you know, we're into Electric Wizard. I like Electric Wizard and Cathedral and, you know, all the, you know, these bands, first wave stoner rock bands or whatever you want to call them. But all those bands, they fucking worship these guys, Leslie and Budgie and Buffalo. And that's like you said, you know, that's the evolution of it. It's the very beginning of it, and it just evolves. And then these young cats and from the 90s, you know, they just take it and they run with it. And it's like, you know, like Sleep and High on Fire. How can we make this heavier, man? It's going to be so fucking heavy, man. It's going to be the heaviest shit ever on the planet and the universe. So, you know, you take fucking Sabbath and Budgie and you turn it up to a million. And that's what you get is you get Sleep Jerusalem. That's what you get. I do have some live Budgie bootlegs. They never release anything official. But I can tell you the one album, a lot of, you know, they have a lot of great albums. it's actually hard to pick. And if you asked me without thinking, I probably would pick Bandolier. It's really accessible, amazing, great production and playing. And there's a song on here called Napoleon Part 1 and 2. It's basically proto thrash. It's proto thrash. It's really fast. It's really heavy. So I probably would say Bandolier. I might have to go with Bandolier, but there's a song on the Whiskey River on here. Ray Phillips. There's Ray Phillips, the original drummer from Budgie. I might have to go with Squawk. It's a tough choice. So probably between Bandolier and Squawk. But if you're looking, because I know you like volume and you're a volume freak, for just like sheer grittiness and heaviness, you might even want to just go with the first album. But you can't go wrong with these three right here. Or this one. Wait, I'm actually picking all of them now, almost. You can't go wrong with any of these, like right here, these four or five or six.
Yeah, the artwork's great. It's one thing I miss a lot in modern...
The album covers?
Releases. Yeah.
They're sick, right?
Yeah.
They're amazing.
You know, obviously the music industry's been decimated, so they don't go out and spend thousands of dollars on artwork these days, which is a disappointment, because you just
which is sad. Yeah, which they should. And they even got, you know, Roger Dean at the time, he was the fucking reigning master of like psychedelia and, you know, base like dreaming up these incredible, you know, dream, like these dreamlike landscapes, these whatever, these nether landscapes of wherever they are. God bless Leslie West and Burke Shelley. Ride on in the Great Gig in the Sky, brothers. And remember, look to the stars, carry the torch of enlightenment, and strive to be a disciple of rock and roll and the Brotherhood of Orpheus.